We want to thank you for joining us at Cowboy Junction Church today. As you hear this message, we pray that your faith will grow and you will be both encouraged and challenged. We would really love it too if you would subscribe, rate, review, and share this online. You can also help us reach others by partnering with us financially. You can easily give a one-time gift or set up a recurring gift at cowboyjunctionchurch.com/give. We hope you enjoy the message today.
You guys ready for today? Turn to 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 1. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 1. We are in the story of Elisha. And Elisha is a fantastic man who is an incredible man of God. This man of God did some really cool things that we're taking a look at. He had astounding faith. His faith in God was amazing. It truly was. But one of the things that we want to pay attention to is we're talking about stronger. Stronger. We've been talking about it all year. But now we're kind of focusing on what a stronger finish looks like. A stronger finish. We're going to take a look at a portion of the Elisha story that I've never taught on in my entire life. I know this is going to be hard to believe. I've always read this, looked at it, had a lot of questions about it. But this story about Elisha seeing an axe head float is something I've never preached on before. In fact, let's just read this. And the sons of the prophet said to Elisha, "See now, the place where you dwell with you is too small for us." Let me give you the backstory on this. There is a school of prophets, okay? There is a prophet mentor program taking place. We talked a little bit about one last week that was taking place, but now you see that Elisha has his own school of prophets going on. And it's this really cool moment to where they've turned to him basically and said, "Elisha, we've met in your living room long enough. We need a place of our own. We need to get out. We need to go see all the things that we need room. We need room." And so they've turned to him and they said, we need to go build some spots. And it says, "Please, let us go to the Jordan," that's a river, "and let every man take a beam from there and let us make there a place where we may dwell." So they've asked permission to go start a building program of their own. They want to build a campus, okay? And Elisha turns and said, "Go." Then one said, "Please consent to go with your servant." They turned back to Elisha and said, "Would you please come with us? It'd be fun to hang out with you. Can you please come help us?" And he said to them, "I will go." So he went with them, and when they had come to the place of the Jordan, they cut down trees. But as one was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. And he cried out and said, "Alas, master, for it was borrowed." And so I'm going to just make sure we understand this picture. They're doing a good work. They're there for a good cause. This young man is working hard. But in the middle of doing everything right, doing exactly what he's supposed to be doing, this young man is on the backswing of his axe, which he's actually borrowed from somebody because it's just going to be a day job. And as he just got through hitting the tree and he's on the backswing, the axe head just flies off. And it flies through the air and it lands in the Jordan River. Splash. What'd y'all think of the sound effects this morning? I've been working all week on this. Aisha, was that spot on? Excellent. I love it. Yeah. And it flies off the axe head. The axe head flies off the handle, lands into the Jordan River, and it's gone. It's gone, long gone. And he turns to the prophet. He says, "Alas, master, for it was borrowed." It's not like I lost my axe head. I lost my friend's axe head. So the man of God said, "Where did it fall?" And he showed him the place. So he cut off a stick, and Elisha threw it in there. And he made the iron float. Therefore he said, "Pick it up for yourself." So he reached out his hand and he took it. Let's just pray. You guys ready? Jesus, touch us. There's somebody in this room that needs this message so bad. I couldn't wait to preach this morning. I'm so excited. I'm so thrilled. Jesus, reveal to us as a church what you revealed to me as an individual in this scripture. We love you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Do you guys ever lose stuff? Do you? Do you ever lose your keys? Do you ever lose your wallet? Do you ever lose your cell phone? Do you ever walk around the house and say, Siri, hoping that she'll answer back? Only the Apple people get that joke. That's pretty handy to know. If you lose your cell phone and you go, "Hey Siri," she'll go ding, and you go, "There you are." "Hey Siri, where are you?" So if you ever lose stuff, like I lose stuff, I just want to talk to you for a minute. I lose things often. Heather is not here today. She was in the first service, but I'm bad about losing things. If you ever see me in public, one of the things you'll notice about, I dress differently a little bit, but I wear my sunglasses around my neck. Everywhere I go, I wear my sunglasses. If you run into me, I'll have my glasses on, but I'll have my sunglasses around my neck. The reason I do this is so I don't lose my sunglasses. But it's not unusual for me to go to Heather and say, "I just can't find my sunglasses anywhere," as they're hanging around my neck. And Heather, being Heather, will turn and go, "Babe, I haven't seen them." And I'll keep looking. I said, "They were right here." She goes, I'll be darned, that's so cool. She gets enjoyment out of seeing me wear my glasses while looking for my glasses. But this story is different than losing something. What if you lost something that you couldn't find? What if you lost something that you couldn't get back? And see, we all lose stuff. We can always get new keys. It may cost us a little bit, we can get new keys. We may lose our phone, but we can get a new phone. It's replaceable. But I want to talk to everybody in the room that you feel like you've lost something that you don't ever think you're going to get it back. And that's what this story means. The story for us to really understand, to some it's just an axe head. To some it's just one more story of the miracle of Elisha. And if we're not careful, what can happen so often in our life is that we can read miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle. We can be numb to the miracle working power of our God. Let me just stop you right now and let me knock some dust off and let me shake you up a little bit. Let me crack an old shell. Let me remind you that you serve the miracle-working God. You serve the God that in one time can ask you to dig some ditches and water will fill those ditches. You may have a small bit of oil. What do you have at home? "I got nothing." Remember that story? "I got nothing but a jar of oil." And God can turn our little bit into all that we could ever need. But when we give him what's in our hands, all of a sudden we find that the miracle begins. He turns the little things into big things. But in this case, you see that there are so many things about this story that it's gone. It's lost. You'll never get it back. And you serve the God that restores. He brings your edge back. Have you ever felt like you lost your edge? You lost your edge, but God brings you back to a place of making you sharp again and making you useful again and bringing the joy back and whatever it may be. In this case, the story really wraps around steel, metal was a very valuable commodity back then. It wasn't like you could just run down to Home Depot and buy a new axe head. And that's something you have to really understand. Someone put material together. Someone had to forge this axe head. Someone shaped this axe head with muscle and a hammer and then put it on a stake that would be the handle and then loaned it to the prophet because he was a good guy and they were doing a good thing. But now the axe head is gone. Have you guys ever borrowed something and broke what you borrowed? A lot of people don't know you're supposed to pay back what you borrowed and broke. But that's just another story altogether, okay? So he now is stuck with this one. I had to borrow because I couldn't afford. And now I got to fix what I can't fix. And so he goes to the prophet. And it was expensive and it hurt. But there's something I want you to get about this story. And here's one of my points. God knows how to help you find what you didn't mean to lose. Sometimes we don't know how we lost it. We don't know where it went. We don't know how we lost our edge. But God knows how to help you find what you didn't mean to lose. And maybe for some of us, it's not an axe head. We've just lost our spiritual edge. There was a time that you remember the zeal you had I'm willing to do anything for you, God. I'm willing to go anywhere for you, God. I'm willing to pay whatever cost needs to be paid. I like the little pearls you had in my life, but I'm willing to sell everything for the pearl of great price. There was so much zeal. There was so much passion. There was a time in your life you said, I went to church. I loved it. It did something for me, and I will never miss again. There was a time that you prayed, and there was something about spending time with God. Your prayer life was sharpened, and you said, I'm going to wake up every day, and I'm going to spend some time with God. You opened up the Bible, and you didn't understand everything you read, but there was something about spending time in His Word, and little things would jump out and sharpen you and encourage you, and you learned more than you'd ever learned before on a specific topic, and you swore, every day I'm going to dive deeper and deeper. Maybe it was a time that you shared Jesus with a friend, and you said, I don't know why I don't tell more of my friends about Jesus. One of your buddy turns one day and says, dude, there's just something different about you. There's just something awesome. What makes you, you? Because me doesn't work. What makes you you and you go, dude, let me just tell you what, it's not me. God's been doing something in my life. Jesus is real, I'm just telling you right now. And right there on the spot, God used you for a friend. You may not have talked to that friend now in 20 years, but there was a time when you said, oh my gosh, what if that happened with all my friends? But that was the last person that you ever told about Jesus. And that was 20, 30 years ago. But on that day, you couldn't figure out why you couldn't tell the whole world about Jesus. I'm not here today to bring condemnation or guilt or anything. The reason why I'm telling you all this is because I have also, at times in my life, lost my spiritual edge. And I hope that's a shocker for you. I hope you go, dude, no way, Pastor Ty. You're always pumped up. You're always excited about Jesus. Man, look at you up there. You just look like you had a Red Bull before you preached today. And I didn't. I just love what I do. I really do. But let me just be honest with you. There are times I lose it. There are times I feel like I lost my axe head. There are times I don't feel sharp. I feel dull. And let me be specific here. Let me share you a personal story. Maybe you've heard me tell you this before, but I just want to be really upfront and honest. And maybe that'll help a lot of people in the room. If you're in the room and you're like, I feel like I've lost my axe head. I feel like it's fell in the Jordan. I was doing everything right and it just fell apart. And you know that being a pastor does not guarantee God's presence? Yeah. And I'm going to just let that sink in because some people, that's a shocker. You're like, oh, no, that can't be. You're the guy on stage. You're the guy with the microphone, even if it doesn't fit you. You're the guy kicking off the building program. You're the guy preaching today. And you're telling me that being a pastor doesn't guarantee God's presence? Absolutely. Absolutely. And let me tell you what messes it up the most. You know what messes up the presence of God in my life the most? Buckle your seatbelt. Pastoring. And let me tell you why. There was a time in my life when I was 18, 19 years old where I just knew God was real. It was over and over again. I could feel the direction I was going, and it was a good direction. I was going to be a great school teacher someday. I was going to be a school teacher. Elementary education was going to be my field. I couldn't wait to be Arnold Schwarzenegger, a kindergarten cop. That I could not wait to have the guitar up there, and the kindergarten kids are going to be the best. I really seriously want to be an elementary education teacher and be a football coach on the side. Yeah, that's going to be me. I couldn't wait. God had other plans. He began to shift me. He said, that's a great plan. It's an incredible plan, but I've got something. Do you trust me? Knowing full well how awesome this would be, do you trust me to go this direction? And I did. I totally trusted him. And I went a completely different route. And I didn't have anything but God. And my faith was big. And it was there that I learned how to pray. And man, I'd get up every day. I would seek God. My prayer life was all I had was God. And I heard someone tell me one time, the most powerful prayer you'll ever pray in your life is the honest prayer. And so for years, I just would be so honest before God. And as honest as I was before God in my prayer life, God would reveal to me some hidden hurts. And God, that person, and God would say, stop. Do you hear what you're saying? You're blaming your heart on them. And I would say, well, God, this is my prayer time. What do I do? And God said, well, you can't change them. You can only change you. And it was in my prayer time, God would begin to take my prayer life into a deeper discipleship, and things would be revealed. It was the coolest thing ever. Same thing in Scripture. I would sit down. I couldn't get enough of revelation. of reading scripture and allowing it to read me. And I hate reading. I hated school. And I wanted to be an elementary education teacher. Yes, yes. But here I was, and I just found myself wanting to know more. I was hungry. Same thing goes for witnessing. There was a time to where I would be laying in bed thinking to myself, you know, today was just so good. Why would I want to end today without telling one person about Jesus? And I mean, just think about it. You're laying in bed. You got your pajamas on, okay? But gosh, you're 18, 19 years old. Where else you gotta be? So you get dressed all over again. And no joke, this is no joke. I used to drive to the Phoenix airport. This is back before 9/11, where you could just go through security, and really basically you just gave a thumbs up at security and they gave a thumbs up to you at security, and you'd walk right through. And I remember going, and this was once a week, every week that I was in Phoenix, when I lived in Phoenix, I would drive to the airport at 10 o'clock at night. I would just go by every gate and I'd pray for Cancun and I'd pray for San Antonio. I prayed for Dallas, and I'd go to every gate, and whichever name was on that gate, I began to pray. And then you'd come across the towns that they just landed, and they had rough, turbulent weather, and they thought they were going to die, and they got off the plane wanting to know more about Jesus, and I'm standing right there, and it's like completely pale. I can tell. You need Jesus, don't you? And I can't tell you how many people, at 19 years old, it was the craziest thing. One time, no joke, they had horrible weather landing, and this guy gets off the plane, and I've got a cross. I got a cross on my necklace, and he goes, come here. Tell me more. Tell me more about Jesus right now. I'm church lady serious. Led the guy to the Lord right there, because I was wearing a cross, and his plane was pitching and ducking, and he was crying out to God, and he didn't even know God on that plane. And I'm church lady serious. I led this guy to the Lord. It was great. But I remember just going to gate to gate. I pray for Houston. I pray for all these places. My faith was so strong. I remember the day when God turned and said, I want you to be a pastor. And I knew one day I was going to be a pastor. I thought, there isn't anything better. Every day you get to pursue Jesus. Every day you get to pray. Every day. And my biggest shocker about being a pastor was this: how fast your personal relationship suffers so that you can be a pastor for the church. And the reason I'm telling you this is because some of you couldn't wait to become parents. And now that you are, kids can ruin your faith. Yeah. And it's not because they're little demons. I mean, they could be. But but it's because all of your attention, all of your focus, you intentionally want to get up early in the morning to spend time with God, but the little suckers can't wake up fast enough. Who am I preaching to? Am I telling you the truth? And now, all of a sudden, they're going to stay in bed if you don't get them up, and you gently go in there because the Spirit of God is upon you, and you go, hey, little guys, I need you to get up. Let's go. And you go back in, and you open your Bible, and you begin to read, but you can't remember anything you're reading because all you can think of, I hear no one moving in the bedroom. And you've just read the entire book of John, and all you can think about is the little suckers aren't listening to me. And now, Jesus stayed on the couch, and you went in, and you're busting chairs, and you're getting kids up to get... And maybe I'm being a little citric there, but you thought this would draw you closer, and it pushes you away. It's funny, as a pastor, your prayer time suffers because you're always praying for people. You're always praying for people. And you would think, well, Ty, you're praying. Yeah, but the thing is I haven't been praying for my wife, and I haven't been praying for my kids, and I haven't been praying for my life as an individual. Reading. The funny thing about reading the Bible, I can read the Bible all day. Fascinating fact about pastoring. For every 1 minute of preaching, I have to study 1 hour's worth of material. Okay? And you would think, well, that's not true. You can't believe what didn't make the cut so that I could be prepared for this message. I felt like the story was so important because you think that being the pastor, you get to spend time with God. I do. I get to spend time with God. But what ends up happening is my personal life suffers if I'm not careful. And I have to be so intentional, because one day I figured out I was losing my edge. I was being a great pastor and I wasn't being a great dad. I was being a great spiritual leader, but I wasn't being a good husband. And I began to realize that this happens in all of our life. At some point, somebody breaks your heart, you swear you'll never be in another relationship. Some pastor makes a big mistake spiritually, morally, you swear you'll never go back to church. You swear you'll never go back to church. Go down the list of all the reasons, all the ways that we can lose our edge. We can lose our axe head in the Jordan. But let's be honest. This story is so important because there are so many details in it that you have to pay attention to. And the detail number one I want you to pay attention to is the young man went to the prophet and said, it was a borrowed axe, what do I do? And the prophet gives something I think every one of us should pay attention to. The prophet turns and he says this in verse 6. So the man of God said, where did it fall? Why is this such a big deal? Because if anybody in the room wants their edge back, you got to remember this point. When God, with God's help, we got to go back. Be honest about where you lost it. You've got to be honest about where you lost your edge. Which means if you're standing there and you've lost your axe, you don't have the edge anymore. One of the most valuable things you can do in your life, if your marriage has lost its sharpness, if your life has lost its sharpness, if your spiritual life has lost its sharpness, don't stay dull. Yeah. Go back to where you lost it and start from there. For a lot of you, you have to go back to the realization of where it began. Who broke your heart? But maybe you can learn some things that you allow Holy Spirit to show you. Now I want to show you that you put way too much faith in a person. And you gave your heart away when you should have guarded it. And now you need to turn and you need to ask me, Father, where did things go wrong? And if you just go back to where you lost it. And for me as a pastor, I'm thinking, I'm a pastor. Why do I feel empty? Why is depression set in? Why is it dark? Why does it hurt? And God would turn and say, go back where you lost it. Well, God, I pray all the time. Oh, that's right. I pray all the time for everybody else, but not for my family. But God, I'm constantly in your word. Oh, that's right. I'm constantly in your word to preach your word, not to be in the word. Yeah. God, I'm always doing for others. But how come I've lost my joy for being a witness in my community? Let me tell you why. Because it's a lot easier to stand up on stage and have people come to you than to trust God in private to go serve the community, not as a pastor, but as a friend. Yeah. Who am I in the public? Not as a pastor, but am I telling my friends about Jesus? And here's a great question. Am I even hanging around the unsaved? Some of you need to make some worldly friends. You thought God was going to pull you out of the world. God wants you in the world, not to act like the world, but to be a light in the darkness. Be honest about where you lost it. And then just go back. The axe head may be in the water, but it doesn't mean that God's not done. My second point is this. With God's help, pick up what you lost. Let me show you what I mean. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 6. And he showed him the place. So he cut off the stick, and Elisha threw it in there, and he made the iron float. Therefore, he said, pick it up for yourself. So he reached out his hand and took it. Here's a big point. I want you to get this. God may make the axe head float, but you got to pick it up. You've got to recognize that you lost the edge. You lost the axe head. And we go back and we figure out, where did I lose it? Why did I lose it? How come I quit here? How come it was downhill from this point on? And then all of a sudden, after you pray about it, God begins to take the old thing and turn around and make it new again. And the axe head floats. But you can't just stand there with the axe head floating. You've got to do something. Pick it up. Pick it up. The story we read last week about digging ditches is the faith story of believing that God can and then doing what God asked you to do. And sometimes readdressing the issue and coming back to the place of understanding that it's now my responsibility, to just simply step into the anointing that God already promised he would do for me and for you. Don't stay dull. Reach down and pick it up. Reach down and do it again. And the young man reached down and picked up the iron head. Some voices will tell you it's too late. You'll never have it again. And God says this, it's never too late. It's never too late for a person to see the power of God do what only he can do. You haven't gone too far. And you haven't done too much. You just need to go back to where you lost it and reach down and pick it up again. In fact, I want you to write a scripture down, okay? I want you to write the scripture down. And this scripture is found in the very last book of the Bible. It's found in Revelation, okay? And it says this, this is in Revelation chapter 2, verse 4. It says, you have forsaken the love you had last. It says, you have forsaken the last love you have. It's not talking about a girlfriend. It's not talking about a boyfriend. It's not talking about a husband. It's not talking about a wife. It's saying your first love, which was God, before everything else, there was a love you had between you and your Father in heaven. It says, but you've forsaken the love that you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. Let me give you the typing version. It says, we've forsaken our first love. And we all need to go back and do the things that we once did that brought about the presence of the one we once loved. This isn't about them right now. Moms, let me talk to every mom in the room. Your kids are amazing. They're God's gift to you. But you need to realize that you in Jesus' time will make you the mom that you're called to be made. You are gifted. You are called. You're kind of like a teacher and a fireman and policeman. They don't pay you enough. I'm telling you, they don't pay you enough. But you're not doing it for the pay, are you? You're not doing it for the pay. But you're going to lose that sharpness. And dads, let me just tell you, if we don't step up and let our wives spend some time with Jesus, we'll have lost the love that we once fell in love with. And you will turn and you will say, she's not the same person. No duh. No duh, man. Come on, let's think about this for a minute. One of the greatest investments you'll make in your family is investing in your wife and allowing her to have some God time. And moms, let me turn to you. There's some times that dad, you need to turn to him and say, give me the remote control. Guys, just listen to me. In a great conversation, dads, just listen to me. Husbands, just listen to me. Wives, if you go turn and say, you don't need TV time right now. TV will never give you what God will give you. Yeah. Okay. And I love TV. Okay. I want my TV. I want my MTV. That's old school right there, isn't it? Right. But there's some times I need to stop and realize that I think I need rest and I think I need a nap. But a nap and rest are good in some moments, but they will never fill me the way that God's presence replenishes me. Yeah. You don't need rest, you need replenish. Yeah. And when we get alone before God, jump in your truck and go for a drive. Seriously, jump in your truck and just go for a drive. And as you make corners, just begin to pray. Allow Holy Spirit to coach on you and guide on you. But you can be no good to everyone if we can't be alone with God as an individual. With God's help, pick up what you lost. In Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 3, and we're going to wrap this up. God, your God, will restore everything you lost. He'll have compassion on you. He'll come back and pick up the pieces from all the places where you were scattered. No matter how far away you end up, God, your God, will get you out of there and bring you back to the land your ancestors once promised. It will be yours again. He will give you a good life and make you more numerous than your ancestors, then the old ways, the new ways, where God's taken you, far exceed anything they ever did. In Luke chapter 12, verse 6, it says this, and this should give some comfort to somebody in the room. Are not five sparrows sold for 2 pennies? Yet not one of them is forgotten by God. Indeed, the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Far more. Come on, who am I praying for today? I just want to have everybody just bow our heads. A minute ago, we cried out to the Lord. We sang some powerful songs. We invited His presence into this place. And I just want you to take a minute and search your heart. How's your edge? How's your edge? Where's your axe head? Was it lost in the Jordan? Did something just, is it gone? Well, it doesn't have to be. And right now in this place, I just want to ask you as a friend, as a pastor, as someone who knows exactly where you are, because I've been there too. I want to ask you a real important question. Do you want your axe head back? Do you want your sharpness again? I want to pray for you. And I want to pray that you would fall in love again with your first love. Not your wife, not your husband, with your Father in heaven. A brand new, fresh beginning. But I want you to be honest. And this is the moment right now that I think is the beginning of the great miracle that God wants to do in the sharpness that you're believing Him for. And I want to ask, if you're in this room and you would go, Pastor Ty, that's me. There is one particular place. There is a place in my life I just feel dull. I don't have that edge like I once did. And I do. I know God's got better for me than for me to walk around with a dull attitude, a dull faith, a dull heart. And I need my sharpness back. And if you're in this room and that's you, would you do something for me? Would you just raise your hand right now? And yeah, you go. All over this place, people. So come on, you need to be honest right now. Be honest. Put your hand up. Put it up, put it down. Yep, all over this place. Yep. Golly. Look at all the people. So many people. Golly. Anybody else? You just weren't honest. You didn't raise your hand. You wish you had of. Just raise your hand right now. All over this place. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. I see it. You know what? I see it. But you know what's more important? God just saw it. And something happened in your heart just now when you raised your hand. You didn't want to because you were dull. You didn't feel like it because you were dull. It was hurting. It hurt to raise your hand because it's just lethargic speaking. And yet you did it anyways, didn't you? And you know what? Something felt good about being honest just now. You haven't given up. You haven't quit. You thought you were done, and all of a sudden, I just want to remind you, you just did something you didn't want to do, and God's about to do something that only He can do. So Father, today I pray for my friends, everyone that raised their hand. And right now in their seat, I just pray that they would begin to talk to You. Jesus, I want to fall back in love with You. I want to have my sharpness back. I'm tired of living a dull life. I'm tired of living a dull love. And I want to go back to my first love. Jesus, I'm going to be a God chaser. I'm going to chase after You. Restore in me the love I have for You. I'm going to chase You with my prayers. I'm going to chase You with my study time. I'm going to chase You with my witnesses. All of a sudden, I'm going to let my light shine in the world that I live in. Jesus, I'm going to chase You. Stepping out in faith. And Father, I pray for every person in this room that's just struggling with that dullness that life can bring. And I pray that before the week is over, they would share their faith with someone they know. Oh, Jesus, do whatever You do. Gosh, we love it. We love it. Let me ask one more question. Is there anybody in the room that you would say, Ty, I don't even know the Lord. But right here in this chair, I realize I need Jesus. I need Jesus. There is a God-sized hole in my heart, and I have ran from God and ran from God. And today I'm running to God. I need Jesus. I want to pray for you, but I didn't know who you are. You would be here today and say, I've never accepted Christ as my Savior. Would you do something for me if you're here today and you would like to accept Christ as your Savior? Would you just raise your hand and I will see it and God will see it. When you raise your hand, I know exactly who I'm talking to. Would you just raise your hand right now? So cool. Okay. Father, I thank you for what you did today. Your great and mighty work. Dust off the old and restore in us who we are in Christ Jesus. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Come on, let's stand to our feet. Okay, listen, everybody look up here. I'm going to let you go. Pick it up. Yes. Turn to your neighbor right now and say, pick it up. Pick it up. Okay, look back at me. Tell me, Pastor Ty, you better pick it up this week. Okay, I'm going to turn back at you and say, listen, pick it up. It's floating. It's fresh. It's new. It's here. Pick it up. Pick it up. I want you to know I love you. Jesus loves you. Don't you ever forget it. God bless you guys and have a great week in the Lord. See you later.